It was a dark and stormy night. The rain fell in torrents, except at occasional intervals, when it was checked by a violent gust of wind which swept up the streets. For it is in London that our scene lies, rattling along the housetops and fiercely agitating the scanty flame of the lamps that struggled against the darkness.
Those are the opening lines of Paul Clifford, an 1830 novel about the adventures of a highwayman who moves into high society. You might not have read it, you've probably not even heard of it, but those first seven words, "It was a dark and stormy night," have become shorthand for hackneyed fiction everywhere. You might think that Charles M. Schulz invented those words for his immortal character Snoopy, who was forever starting his would-be novels with them. But in fact, they were penned by Edward Bulwer-Lytton, an enormously prolific and successful novelist of the Victorian age. His most famous work is The Last Days of Pompeii, thanks to no less than 10 film versions. He's also responsible for several phrases which are now part of our common language.
The pursuit of the almighty dollar.
The great unwashed.
The pen is mightier than the sword.
Actually, the full version of that quote is, "Beneath the rule of men entirely great, the pen is mightier than the sword." Edward Bulwer-Lytton was one of the best-selling authors of his day, second only to Charles Dickens. He's credited by some as pioneering two literary genres, the historical and science fiction. He was a great statesman, served for Parliament, and he lived here at the majestic Knebworth Castle. Yet today, he's almost completely forgotten. Except for students of Victorian literature, the only place people are likely to hear his name is in the annual Bulwer-Lytton Writing Competition. It's a light-hearted literary challenge celebrating deliberately awful writing. So what happened? Edward George Earl Bulwer-Lytton was born on the 25th of May, 1803, the youngest of three sons. His early childhood was similar to many others of the landed gentry, and it was not until his teenage years that his interest in writing emerged. Edward studied at Trinity College, Cambridge, and toured Europe, soaking up new experiences. But at this time, his main interest was in poetry. He won the Chancellor's Medal for one piece, entitled Sculpture, and this gave him the confidence to self-publish an anthology entitled Weeds and Wildflowers. In 1827, he married Rosina Doyle Wheeler, a beautiful, strong-willed Irish woman who shared many of his interests. Unfortunately, his mother bitterly opposed his marriage and stopped his income. Edward had no choice but to write for a living and wasted no time in putting pen to paper. His first novel, Falkland, aroused little interest, but his second, Pelham, hit gold, becoming a bestseller in high society, concerning the adventures of a young dandy. Following the old adage that one should write about what one knows, and inspired by the piles of bills on his desk, Edward wrote with furious energy, copying the success of Pelham with similar novels filled with satirical melodrama and colourful city characters. Sure enough, he achieved more bestsellers with The Disowned, Devereux, and Paul Clifford. With fame came more responsibility. He landed the role as editor of the imaginatively titled New Monthly Magazine. He was elected Liberal MP for St Ives and Lincoln, and he published four more novels. But the strain was beginning to take its toll. Rosina and Edward's marriage began to break down, and in 1834, they were temporarily separated. His nerves worn and suffering from exhaustion, Edward finally needed a holiday.
Spending time in the Italian sunshine not only improved his health, but inspired him to write his most famous work, The Last Days of Pompeii. Like many of today's disaster movies, the personal stories of several characters, including Glaucus, a Greek gladiator, and Olympus, an early Christian, are set against the destruction of the city. He was a strong believer in doing good research for his novels and scrupulously studied Roman culture. The resulting novel was not only a great success, but in fact Edward has a fair claim to being the creator of the modern historical novel.
Before him, how serenely slept the starlight on that lovely city, how breathlessly its pillared streets reposed in their security. How softly rippled the dark green waves beyond. How cloudless spread aloft and blue the dreaming companion skies. Yet this was the last night for the gay Pompeii, the fabled city of Hercules, the delight of the voluptuous Roman. Age after age had rolled indestructive, unheeded over its head, and now the last ray quivered on the dial plate of its doom.
Bulwer-Lytton was quick to capitalize on the success and followed it up with several more historical novels, including Harold, Last of the Saxons, and Rienzi, a Roman tragedy that was turned into a popular opera by Richard Wagner.
Wagner himself was later dismissive of the work, and it is rarely performed now, possibly because it's 6 hours long. Maybe another reason for its lack of popularity is its association. One young man who saw this tale of a visionary leader who creates a mighty republic later wrote in his diary, "At that moment, it began." His name was Adolf Hitler. In 1836, his marriage to Rosina had disintegrated. They were officially separated, and it marked the beginning of an acrimonious relationship which lasted to the end of his life. 3 years after the divorce, Rosina published her own first novel, Chievely, a thinly veiled vitriolic caricature of her ex-husband. She would go on to write 17 more books and become something of a success in her own right. In 1843, Edward's estranged mother passed away, finally. Now a baronet for his services to literature, Edward inherited his family home of Nebworth Castle and soon became known for hosting many sumptuous parties for the cream of London literary society. Amongst the many young authors invited were Wilkie Collins and his friend Charles Dickens.
There is some debate over when Edward had his first meeting with Charles Dickens. Whenever it was, either through a shared publisher called Henry Colburn, or later through mutual friends, the two struck up a great rapport. At the time, Bulwer-Lytton was the senior, more famous writer, and he became one of Dickens' early champions. In fact, in 1861, he persuaded Charles to change the original downbeat ending of Great Expectations into something happier and more romantic, somewhere where Pip marries Estella and lives happily ever after. Charles, in turn, named his 10th and last child after Edward, and it once described him as the most brilliant conversationalist of his age.
Edward was also making a number of influential friends in politics. The great Victorian statesman, Benjamin Disraeli, himself also a noted novelist, persuaded Edward to stand for election as a Conservative in Hertford. When he ran for re-election in 1858, Rosina frequently appeared at the hustings to loudly denounce him. Eventually, she was arrested, bound over, and placed in an asylum for several weeks until liberated by friends. In the meantime, Edward was returned as MP and served as Secretary of State for the colonies. Eventually, he would take a peerage and sit in the Lords as Baron Lytton of Nebworth. Not that he let his political roles interfere with his writing. Like many wealthy Victorians, Edward had an interest in the occult, and this came through into several of his books. In Zanoy, for instance, about a handsome young man who seems to have discovered the secret of eternal life. Or A Strange Story, in which a doctor has to outwit a rival who has terrible magical powers. But it was the coming race that really established his reputation in the fantasy field. In this, a young American traveller discovers a secret civilization underground, ruled by a race of super beings known as the Vril Yar. The Vril Yar use a substance called Vril to give them incredible powers, and it can also be used as a terrible weapon. The book is partially a comment on the new ideas of Darwinism that were coming into the popular debate, and also the growing feminist movement.
It was the face of man, but yet of a type of man distinct from our known extant races. The nearest approach to it in outline and expression is the face of the sculptured Sphinx, so regular in its calm, intellectual, mysterious beauty, with large black eyes, deep and brilliant, and brows arched. A nameless something in the aspect, tranquil though the expression, and beauteous though the features, roused that instinct of danger which the sight of a tiger or serpent arouses. As it drew near, a cold shudder came over me. I fell on my knees and covered my face with my hands.
The book was enormously popular and even prompted a brief fashion for Vril products, one of which is still with us today. Bovril, bovine, and Vril. More disturbingly, although Bulwer intended the book to be purist fiction, some people took it seriously and believed that there really was a super race beneath us. The book was very popular amongst Nazi occultists, possibly who felt that an Aryan super race waiting to inherit the Earth was somehow an attractive idea. In fact, it's even rumoured that Hitler authorised many expeditions into mines across Europe searching for an entrance to the land of the Vril Yar. His novels were being translated into many languages across Europe, and in fact, Ernest Maltravers became the first English language book to be translated into Japanese. His House of Lords career was relatively quiet, and he was spending more time researching into esoteric matters. As part of this, he became a founding member of the English Rosicrucian Society, a group of men interested in studying ancient practices such as astrology and alchemy. Lord Lytton died on the 18th of January, 1873, in Torquay, with his son and heir, also named Edward, at his bedside. Woody Allen once said, "I don't want to be immortal through my work. I want to be immortal by living forever." But in truth, most writers hope that they will have an existence beyond death through their work. Most never achieve it. But it's a sad irony in Bulwer-Lytton's case that this most admired and popular author in his day should now be almost completely forgotten. Mary Shelley wrote in her journal in 1831, "What will Bulwer become? The first author of the age, I do not doubt it. He is a magnificent writer. Yet it is her name and Frankenstein that is part of our culture, whilst the author of Pelham is remembered only by an academic jape and a hot beef-flavoured drink."